Hello, I'm Bob Gwynne. I'm a curator here at the National Railway Museum, and today we're going to do Curator with a Camera. Well, here we are with Eurostar. This is number 3308. This was actually built for the North of London Eurostar services that never happened. But it's fundamentally a Eurostar that shows us everything that Eurostar is as a service and its whole history. And it's easily the most complex vehicle we have at the National Railway Museum. When the Channel Tunnel opened in 1994, it was the first time that Britain had been connected to Europe since the Ice Age, really. The tunnel was easily the most complex piece of engineering to open that year by long chalk, the longest underwater tunnel in the world. And it allows passengers to travel seamlessly from Britain to France, from the capitals of London, Paris and Brussels. So it's pretty impressive as a piece of infrastructure that connects us under the short sea of the Channel. The Eurostar behind me is an important part of that story because it's how you get a passenger train through that tunnel at high speed. Starting at the front, you can see this beautiful streamlined shape, which came about really as modifications of the Train de Grande Vitesse in France, the TGV. And that this is like a TGV, but it's slightly smaller and narrower because we have a different loading gauge in the UK. When we go down it, we can see, for example, the depot it was based at, which is North Pole. North Pole was the depot named after a pub in London. I like to think it came to us as a Christmas present in 2015. Then if we look at the Eurostar logo on the side there, you've got three flashes above that point to a star. Actually, they spell an E, really, pointed to the star, Eurostar, and they represent the three different countries, France, Belgium, and the United Kingdom. All the way down the train, you've got things like this, which is a pictogram showing you where there's a test button for the sander system and another pictogram for where you can actually lift it up. Because of course, your engineers are three different countries of engineers. Therefore, you have to be careful of those different languages. They're all the way down here. Here's the works plate for the machine, which tells you it was built in 1995. The first ones of these came out in 1994. There's even an indicator here that tells you whether that brake is on or off on the bogie. So if there's a brake fault, be easy to find. The outside has got louvered, which helps drive some air into the interior to try and make sure it stays cool because it's got a lot of electrical equipment there. And along here, you've even got a sign that shows that it used to have, when it ran out of Waterloo, it used to have a third rail. A third rail system, which is what the United Kingdom has a lot south of the river, came in 1904. And this machine was quite capable of doing 100 miles an hour on the third rail system out of Waterloo. So again, it's a harbinger of high speed in the UK. So it's a very important machine. Now, if we step right back, we can see up there, there's a pantograph up there. That's the for the Belgian system, the 3000 DC volt system. And then tucked in is the 25 kV pantograph. So you have to put up a different pantograph for which system you're using. It does that seamlessly as it's going along. It's able to switch at speed, at 187 miles an hour, it can switch voltages. Which is pretty impressive. Come round the back of it, and you know, it's got a Scharfenberg coupler, which is a very modern automatic coupling system. There's its thing for connecting up all the power cables and things between the coaches and the train, the locomotive itself. There's the fire suppressant system in case there's a problem. You can see it says fire bottle isolated, and then the power cables that come down the train. There's even, like on the Shinkansen, there's even a sort of rubber fairing system here that means that you have a seamless, streamlined exterior as you go down the train. Unusually, this sign here shows when it was painted, which is August in 1994. So this is the original Eurostar livery, but this is the only train in the National Railway Museum that's never been repainted. This is original paintwork. A few more of those pictograms that go down the side that help you understand how to do things like how to isolate the brakes. Here's one. And underneath the covers, it's all the equipment that you require to do all sorts of things that make sure you can maintain the machine, and if there's any fault, you can locate it quickly. And then finally, at this end of the train, you can look at that shape. You can see how it's all aerodynamically designed, because A, you're going into a very big tunnel, but also out in the countryside at large, you've got the ability to cut through the air very quietly, smoothly, at high speed. It's designed around high speed. It's designed around to take the amount of passengers as you'd have on a jumbo jet. And it's done extremely well. Effectively, Eurostar has emptied the airlines between London, Paris, and Brussels. So that's our introduction to the Eurostar 3308. And hopefully our special guest, Chris from Eurostar, is here.
Hello, Bob. Want to come look inside?
That would be great. So here we are coming into the Eurostar, and here's our special guest, Chris McCandless-Stone, who is the Fleet Performance Manager at Eurostar. Okay, Chris, can you show us how this works? How do you power it up, and what are the systems you can see here?
Sure, let's start in the armoire de cabine, or the control cubicle. So in here, we've got all of the main circuit breakers and the switches for the main systems on the train. And this is the important one here. We'll turn on the batteries, and normally it would go, but not today, because there's no batteries in. And then we'll move to the driving desk. So we'll put the main key switch in. It's a nice red key switch for the North London service. We'll put the key switch in and we'll select our voltage. Now, as we discussed with Bob earlier, we've got lots of voltages here. We could be on the British Rail 25 kV, the high speed line, the British Rail third rail shoe gear, Eurotunnel, so TVM 413 cab signalling, 25 kV overhead line AC pantograph at an extended height. The wire in the Eurotunnel is higher than it is elsewhere. French LGV or Ligne Grand Vitesse. So the French high-speed line, TVM 430 signalling, 25 kV AC overhead line power systems. French classic lines, so French 25 kV AC overhead line power systems and KVB signalling system. And Belgian 3 kV DC overhead line power supply and TBL signalling system. So let's go for a bit of out of Waterloo nostalgia. We'll put the shoe gear down. We'll put the shoe gear down. We'll go for normal because we're going to put the shoes at both ends on. And we wait for the shoes to go down. Now, hopefully, Bob, the shoes will go down and they'll touch the third rail. We'll have a bit of a crack. And we'll see the indicator here go from the red up to the green. That shows that we've got power. And when we've got power, we can ask for permission to close the circuit breaker. A little bit later, the egg box here will flash up with a green light to say that we're all systems go. The train is configured. It knows it's in 750 volts. It sees 750 volts DC, and we can close the circuit breaker. So there we are. We've closed the circuit breaker. We're now ready to roll. So we're going to go into forward. And then we're going to select T for traction. And then once we move the power controller forward, we're slowly accelerating up to a whopping 12 megawatts or 16,000 horsepower at the wheels. As you slow down to a more normal speed, we can use a normal brake controller here. So we can apply the brakes by pulling back and push the brakes forward to release the brakes. And we've got brake gauges up here that show the pressures in the brake pipe. And if you're really needing to stop quickly, we've got a red emergency mushroom, which we can slam down to stop the train from 300 kilometers an hour to zero. But in about 2.5-3 miles, so you travel a fair distance. So there's a number of different radio systems on the train. So here we have the cab secure radio, or the international train radio. So in the southern region it serves as the CSR, and on the continent and in the channel tunnel is the ITR for the driver. That's one handset. This being a North London train set would have gone north of London up to Scotland and Glasgow and Newcastle. So here we have the national radio network, or the NRN radio, as is more familiar on a lot of UK trains, and a little bit more old-fashioned on the handset. And then this little gem here, the little red handset, this is just for use by the train crew and Eurotunnel in case of any emergency situations. And we almost forgot the most important part of the cab, Bob. In here we have the fridge, because every driver needs to keep his cheese and wine for the journey.
So Chris, can we now, having seen the cab interior, can we go and have a look through the engine compartment?
Let's do it. This way, Bob. So here we are as we leave the cab. So just past the transformer here, we've got the bloc commun, or the common block. So this takes the 25,000 volts AC from the overhead line in France and on the high speed line, the 3,000 volts DC from the overhead line in Belgium, and the 750 volts DC from the third rail, and converts it all into one voltage, because the train motors themselves can't drive on three voltages, they can only work on one. Up here there's a panel with a very curious little a C and a key shaped thing, and I've managed to get hold of one of these keys here. It's a little earthen key with 3308 stamped on it, and this key goes into the lock if we jiggle around. And inside this panel we should find some of the control system. It's a bit dark, but we can just about make out some, there's some contactors in here and some isolators, so they do the various control mechanisms for the train. As we reach the back of the power car, we can see some big stacks on the left and the right. These are the rear static brakes, so they do the braking when you're on they put the motors into reverse, and they drive the train a bit like when your airplane comes into land. They put the motors into reverse, the wheels don't run backwards, but they become generators, and then they put air out as heat, but they slow the train down as well. Behind us here, there's a very big lump. This is the main compressor. So this generates the air that's required on the train. Now we need air to do the brakes, we need air for the secondary suspension in the passenger coaches to give a nice smooth journey, and we need the air for the horn, of course, the nose doors. So there's various bits that go with the air system, some dry towers here because we want to make sure that our air is nice and dry. And then here we've got this red handle. So I showed you earlier about the C key that gets us into the train. And before you go into the live cubicles, you need to make sure you earth the train. So whenever the train's powered up, the earthing switch is in its normal position, and we earth the train down with this red handle, and it makes a big clunk, and then that will release another key. And if we go round to the common block on this side, we can see this key panel here. So we can see here there's the B key, and next to it there's some lights in here. These would normally be lit up, and we watch these lights go out. That's confirming that all the voltage inside the common block is dissipated, and therefore when you go inside with your C key, you're not going to get electrocuted. We can see here there's a whole lot of C keys. If we take, let's take another one, let's see what's inside another panel. Here we go, there's another C key here from 3308. They're all stamped with a power car number. It's very important that we don't get confused. And we're doing a bit of jiggery. We put that into the lock here, and we turn the C key on the lock. And we're going to go in here, we're going to see the high speed circuit breaker for the DC. So this is for the third rail shoe gear and the 3000 volts DC when operating in Belgium. So there we go, we'll slide that panel out of the way, and this is what we do in the maintenance depot if you needed access. We can see here there's some more isolators, so they are used to switch the power in the various voltages. And then there's this really big orange block here, and this big orange block is like a light switch, a massive light switch that turns the 3000 volts DC or the 750 volts DC, lots of current, lots of amps, directly from the third rail shoes or from the pantograph into the common block and supplies the power. So when the driver does his small little switch with his green indicator on the desk, this is what closes to allow the power actually into the train. And if we carry on back the other way as well, we can see here, so we need to operate KST03 earthed à la masse, so en français, or down to earth, must be earthed. And then we can see here, this is the motor blocks, there's one on the left and one on the right. So BM1 on the left does the first bogies wheels, and BM2 on the right does the second bogies. BM1's already been opened for us to show it so we can see inside. There's a little bit of a control rack here on the left that does all the processing power. So the driver asks for 300 kilometers an hour and he gets 300 kilometers an hour. Some relays, a few push buttons and isolation switches. And then let's go and see what's in here. So we've got some modules, some power modules. They do all the driving of the train when the driver's trying to take power. So these take in 1900 volts DC, so a bit like a battery. The Eurostar was one of the first vehicles in the UK certainly to use AC asynchronous motors. Oh, mind you, Ed. So these are the power modules, so they do the switching, and they're oil cooled. So in these pipes here there's oil, that's what cools the motors down, and there's a big reservoir for oil here. We can see that it's just above the filling level, so we'll have to tell the depot to top it up soon. And in here there's a radiator, some big transformer ferrites, and some various smaller other control gear. And okay, I think that's the power car interior in a nutshell.
Well, thanks for showing us around, Chris. And don't forget, if you've enjoyed this episode, leave a like or do subscribe, and come again next time and see Curator with a camera.